And then you also begin to see the rise of conservative crime control policies. If we install mandatory minimums, and if we install three strikes legislation, and if we ratchet up use of the death penalty, perhaps we will begin to get control of the country. Well, there's a price to be paid for that on the other side, in which these were all policies that would adversely affect African Americans, and there appeared to be no real attempt on the part of the Republicans to look at the legitimacy and the fairness of these policies. We all know about the sentencing disparities that occur all over the place in terms of crack versus cocaine and other issues. But the one that really troubles me is felon disenfranchisement. We live in a country in which if you commit a crime in many parts of the country, you do your time, you're released, but you're not allowed to vote. Now, there's nothing in the U.S. Constitution, from my reading of it, that says it is you sort of lose your citizenship because you've committed a crime. But the way, in many cases, Republicans have pushed some of these laws around the country, particularly in the South, many, if not all, African Americans who are convicted of crimes, and this is not just an African American thing, but are convicted of crimes, are then permanently disenfranchised and then have to go back and try to regain their right to vote. Now, this is an onerous, long, drawn-out process that in many cases takes years and years to make happen, and it rarely works. So as a consequence, there are hundreds of thousands of African Americans, particularly in the South, who can't vote. Now, why is that significant? Well, if you look at the state of Florida, for example, in the 2000 election, if you look at voting patterns and you allow for drop off in voting because felons don't vote at the same rates as wouldn't vote at the same rates as everyone else, you would find that in 2000, Al Gore more than likely would have taken Florida by a larger number than he actually did. Okay, so if you say that's the case in Florida, and then you look at other states in which there are large numbers of African Americans who are incarcerated or have had their voting privileges taken away from them, then you say, well, wait a second, what then happens in Georgia? You know, what then happens in Missouri? What then happens in some of these other states in which there are very close margins that determine who wins that state's electoral votes and who doesn't? Okay, so the felon disenfranchisement issue, from my perspective, is really one at the top of the list of those issues that need to be addressed with regard to public policy that's been pushed by the Republican Party that's had a real negative impact on African Americans. But it's not just public policy. As I indicated earlier, it's also political symbolism. We all know about the Southern Strategy, which was launched in the 1964 presidential campaign of Barry Goldwater, was perfected 4 years later by Richard Nixon, and has been used in various levels, in various ways, at state, local, and national elections all around the country ever since. You know, the Southern Strategy has really provided a launching point for those who want to engage in political symbolism in this new era of American politics. The one I really want to emphasize today, though, is one that inflames a lot of people, myself included, and that is the use of Willie Horton in the 1988 presidential campaign. And we all understand that this was overt and, at some level, pathological political symbolism. But in my research, I uncovered some things that I thought were pretty curious, one of which was Willie Horton never actually went by the name Willie Horton. His name was William J. Horton. Friends and family called him Will. Willie was created by Lee Atwater. And Willie Atwater and Roger Ailes, in particular Ailes, decided from a symbolic standpoint, the only question about how we're going to depict Willie Horton is whether or not we're going to put a knife in his hand. Now, they ended up not doing that because they were able to get the symbol they wanted and have some sort of plausible deniability. But the fact that they changed his name for symbolic purposes, I think, was pretty important. Now, there's more to the story, as I indicated earlier. As you all know, Ronald Reagan was governor of California. And during his time as governor, a police officer and a school teacher were both killed by furloughed prisoners. Now, they didn't hear about that very much during the campaign, I don't think. I don't recall hearing very much of it. But, of course, the Bush campaign wouldn't mention that because that would cut against their interest. Also, in Massachusetts, at about the same time as Willie Horton came up, there was a police officer, a white police officer, who killed a friend over some insurance money. Now, what the Bush campaign did was, in focusing on Willie Horton, was ignore the white killer and in favor of focusing on the black rapist. The sort of symbolism that is all too prevalent in political campaigns around the country. We know about purge programs all over the place. What can we do to reduce the number of black voters who are likely to vote Democratic? Voter purging from the rolls, voter suppression activities. You may have recalled Michigan State Senator who said, if we don't suppress the vote in Detroit, we're going to lose. Pretty overt about it, okay? But these programs go on all over the place, and it's up to diligent and fair-minded people to identify these programs and also to call attention to them. More symbolism. The welfare queen. You all will recall that President Reagan used this fictitious woman who, in every possible newscast, was a black woman of a certain size, of a certain look, of a certain demeanor, who symbolized Republican arguments that the poor people have too much money. The poor people have too much money. And the proof of it is this welfare queen who goes to pick up her check in a Cadillac. Okay? So that's the Republican thesis. The poor have too much money. The rich don't have enough money. And that our international problems can be solved through military action. So the welfare queen came to be a tremendous symbol for Republicans to beat back what they saw as the encroachment or the over-encroachment of racial liberalism. Now, these are all old examples. And you may be saying, well, wait a second, that's a long time ago. What about recently? Well, some of you may recall just a week or so ago, Virginia State Delegate Hargrove, I believe is his name, said that we don't need to do an apology to blacks for slavery. In fact, black people, you just need to get over it. It's in the past. You weren't a slave. Your grandparents weren't slaves. Just get over it. Okay? Well, that kind of stuff goes on from elected officials all over the country and elected and campaign strategists all over the country. And it's the sort of thing that rises its ugly head every so often just to let you know that the country, while it has made a tremendous amount of changes over the years, is still not where it needs to be.